Excited this evening? Come on, can you make some more noise? A little more louder. 1, 2, and 3, come on. Okay, so what I'm going to do is, I've got this great band with me over here. I'm going to ask all of them to play, and we all are going to shout together. Are you ready? Let's do it together as loud as you can. At the count of 1, 2, and 3, okay. 1, 2, and 3, come on. This evening. Yes, together. excited? Come on, can you make some noise? Okay, we're going to do this song that's called This Is The Day You've Made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. How many of you know this song? Okay, just the thing is that it's not the old song. It's a little newer song. So join along with us as we sing this song. Come on. You gotta shout it. Whoa.
Oh, so my heart will sing.
excited this evening to have Rudy over here. Okay, so without taking much time, as you all know, he comes from Planet Shakers. He's a worship leader at Planet Shakers. And how amazing it is that he has come to us. Amen. Amen. And this evening, can you all give him a very big Chennai welcome? Come on. Would you welcome him? Come on, don't stop. Don't stop.
How you doing tonight, everybody? Come on, does anybody love Jesus in this room? So here's the thing. We're about to do another praise song. There's something that we talk about at our home church in Melbourne, Australia. We believe the church should be the greatest party on the planet. Does anyone believe that? You know why I believe that? I believe we got the greatest reason to celebrate. We got the greatest reason to praise. His name is Jesus. He's the one who saved us. He healed us. He set us free. He delivered us. So all over this room, from the very back to the very front, would we lift up a shout of praise to King Jesus in this place? Come on, New Life. Come on, lift him high. Come on, lift him high. Come on, praise him tonight. Praise him tonight. Come on, praise him, church. Hey. Here's the other thing about a party is I believe that our God deserves all of our praise. And so I want you to do me a favor. I want you to just grab the person next to you and just shake them by the shoulders and just say, it's time to take your praise to another level. And here's the thing. This is what we teach our church back home in Australia. God deserves all of our praise, our heart, our mind, our soul, and our body. So I know that y'all in India can dance. I was at a wedding last night. I know you can dance, and you can dance better than me. I know it. You know it. Here's the thing. I believe that we need to give God all of our praise tonight. So here's the deal. We're going to do this next song. I want to see this whole place erupt with praise. Are you ready to go? Come on, church. Let's go.
Through you, I can do anything. I can do all things. 'Cause it's you who gives me strength. Nothing is impossible.
greatest? Do you believe that Jesus can do anything? Well, here's the thing. I want to stir you up in your praise. I reckon we got about 20% of the room right now is giving God all their praise. But I want us to take our praise to another level tonight. So can you do me a favor? From the back to the front, can you raise your hands high? Now join me. 1, 2, 3. Now come on, keep clapping. As you're clapping, I want to hear you declare it tonight. Can you sing with me? Sing. I believe, I believe. I believe, I believe in you.
I believe, I believe.
Now just you? All the music cut out, just drums. Keep singing. I believe. Music back in. You're doing good. You can bring your hands down. That was just the start. But now I want us to take it to another level. I want you to copy me, all right? This is what we're going to do. We're going to do this. We're going to do this. On the count of three. 1, 2, 3. All right. About half the crowd did that. If you're standing next to someone who didn't do that, I want you to just shake them up a little bit. And we're going to do it again. I can see you from the back to the front. Come on, church, here we go. 1, 2, 3. I can still see about a third of the room that didn't do it. Come on, grab your neighbor again and just shake them up and say, come on, every person, we're going to do this. Are you ready? 1, 2, 3. That's pretty good. Now we've got to put it all together. 1, 2, 3, 4. Come on, from the back to the front, church. Let me see you dance. Let me see you praise. Let me hear you sing. 1, 2, 3, 4. Take a moment, close your eyes, raise your hands up high. We're going to step into a time of worship, into the presence of God. The Bible says that God inhabits the praises of His people, that God is enthroned upon the praises of His people. And we praised God tonight, which means God's presence is here, His power is here. And I want to encourage you all over this room that whatever it is that you need, you would reach out to Him in this moment. Come on, I believe nothing is impossible without God. That in His presence, anything can happen. Come on tonight, set your sights upon Him. Set your attention upon Him. My life to you.
you come and move. Oh, I'm taking hold of the edge of your garments, 'cause I believe what I want. I'm reaching out in this miracle moment. You're always true to your word, Lord. You're always true to your word. So I open up my heart to you. I open up my life to you. Jesus, won't you come and move, oh. And I surrender every part of me, and now I'm ready to receive, yeah. Jesus, won't you come. From heaven flowing in this place, everybody welcome, Jesus King of heaven, the glory of his presence is filling up this place. Here in this moment anything can happen, miracles from
Set upon heaven tonight. Jesus, we set our sights upon you. As we gaze upon the beauty of your glory, Lord, we know that nothing is impossible. That Jesus, that's what you did when you went to the cross, that you took upon yourself our sin, our shame, sickness, brokenness. God, that now in your presence, there's nothing that needs to stand between us and your love. So God, we step boldly into your presence in this moment. Holy Spirit, I'm asking right now that you would come and move. That you would come and do what only you can do. Jesus, we lift you up as the greatest in this room tonight.
This evening. Okay, so I would want you all to stand once again as we enter into worship. How many of you want to continue to do this? Yes? Let's go on. sing it out with me if you know this song.
Jesus, beautiful Savior, God of all majesty, risen King, Lamb of God, holy and righteous, blessed Redeemer, bright morning star,
all the heavens.
How beautiful, name about it.
shout his name, Jesus. Jesus, your name, Jesus. Jesus, your name. Beyond the songs, beyond the sound, beyond the people on stage, God, we lift you up. The name that is above every name. The name at which every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. We lift the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. And God's people said, come on, God's people said, would you give the Lord a hand of praise this evening? Amen. You may be seated. Don't go back. We have a lot more things planned. Please be seated wherever you are. God bless you.
Hey, Nalaji Chennai. How are you guys doing? Come on, make some more noise, Nalaji. Amen. It's a one-of-a-kind evening service that we have planned today, and I think we need to thank God, and let's give a round of applause to Jesus for this evening that he's enabled us to put together. And as we're going to go into a time of message, we're going to hear the word of God being preached. It once again, I take an immense privilege. I consider this as an honor to introduce the pastor for us who's going to come and preach the word. We heard Rudy. How many of you were here when Rudy was leading praise and worship this evening? Were you here? Can I see your hands? Okay, and now we're going to hear Rudy preach. And Rudy is not just a person who just sings songs and releases various songs, but he's also a pastor for the Planet Shakers Melbourne campus. He's also the pastor for the Planet Shakers University, which is across Melbourne, Australia, and there are close to 4,000 students who are part of this university program for Planet Shakers. He is passionate about preaching the word and he is committed to leading people and equipping people to really serve the Lord. So can we put our hands together one more time and welcome Rudy to come and share the word for us this evening.
Well, good evening. Isn't it good to be in church? It's my favorite place to be. Here we are, Sunday evening in Chennai. What time is it back home? It's 11 p.m. I'd normally be in bed after a long Sunday. We're normally in church four times on a Sunday, so I feel like I've had a holiday today. I'm just in church once, so we better make it good, hey? Anyone love church? Well, I want to introduce myself to you. Obviously, you just heard that I pastor and I lead worship back home in Melbourne, Australia, and have a great time doing that. I'm traveling with some friends of mine. This is John and Val in the corner. They're on staff at Planet Shakers as well. We were all in a wedding last night in Cochin, And so we were so close, we thought we'd fly up here today and say hello and spend the afternoon with you in church. And let me tell you, it's such an honor to be with you in church. And you are part of an amazing church. Can you thank God for your pastors and your leaders? And so great. And I got a couple of photos to introduce my family to you. This is my wife, Chelsea. And this is my newborn child. This was just a few weeks ago before we decided to throw her in the river and baptize her by full immersion. I figured, you know, she'd lived about 10 weeks of living, lots of sinning. I'm like, let's get her baptized really quickly. Because my wife and I had some wayward times in our childhood. I wanted to take care of it. But I got one more picture. And this is a close-up of my child. There she is. She's 4 months old now. Just this week, we got her weighed. And the doctor said she is heavier than 98% of all other babies. She's a fat kid, man. We've been feeding her good. And the doctor said, I'm not concerned, but if she was at 100%, I'd be sending you to the doctor. And I'm like, well, that's funny. But she's tall as well. She's fat and tall. And so that's my daughter. Her name is Aria. And my wife's name is Chelsea. You can take her down, otherwise I'll get distracted. But she's our first child. And so she was born 4 months ago. And it's been hilarious becoming a dad for the very first time. And they tell you that you discover when you become a parent, you discover a love that you never knew you had before. And let me tell you, young people, it's true. She's 4 months old. Man, something's happened in my heart. I never knew that I loved sleep as much as I do. I think about it all the time. I long for it. I go to work and I think about it. I come home and I think about it. It's a dream. But, you know, when she was born, her name is Aria, which in Hebrew means lioness of God. And when she was born, we took one look at her. I'm like, yep, she's our little lioness. Because you could see she had like a full head of hair on her when she came out. But not only that, she had hair all over her body. Like a gross amount of hair. Like if you were to look at her shoulders, like the hair was so long, you could part it and curl it or straighten it, depending on what mood you were in. Like it kind of curled around all on its own. She had hair all up and down her back. I took one look at her when she came out. I'm like, she came out with her winter coat on. She really is a lion. Oh my gosh. But, people keep encouraging me. They're like, it's all good. It'll fall out. It hasn't. But they're like, it'll fall out. I just keep encouraging my little daughter. She can't understand me yet, but I just keep telling her. I said, baby, it's okay. It's 2019. There's solutions for hair like this. Lasers. But she's hilarious, you know. Having a little human that can't speak any language yet, all they can do is cry. And so their only method of communication is crying. And so my job as her dad is to work out how to translate cry into English. I'm like, okay, what does this cry mean? Is she cold? Is she hot? Is she got gas? Is she hungry? Did she just wet her diaper? I don't know. But I feel like after 4 months, I've kind of got the hang of it. It's like, okay, I think I know what that cry means. I know what that one means. I recognize now when she's dirtied her diaper, I'm like, I know what she's doing. I know what's going on. I look over, she's got an intense look of concentration on her face. I'm like, I know what you're doing. And then she begins to cry because she's uncomfortable. Wouldn't we all be? But as her dad, the moment that I work out what's wrong, I pick her up and I start walking her towards her bedroom so I can lay her in her room and take care of the problem. Now, you and I all understand in that moment exactly what I'm doing. She's made a mess. I'm going to go and clean that mess. The thing is, she's too young right now to understand what I'm doing. All she knows is she's uncomfortable, and I picked her up. I've taken her to her room. I've laid her down. She's all right. And then I'd start to strip off her clothes. And then I undo her diaper, and I look at the mess that she's made. Don't picture it. Blah. And
Then I get a cold, wet wipe. And I start wiping her off. But in her mind, she's gone from being warm and slightly uncomfortable to having something freezing cold thrust where all of us would find it a little bit uncomfortable. And all of a sudden, in that moment, she goes from being slightly uncomfortable, like, to like, wah! Because I've just shoved something quite cold and wet where, you know, exactly. You and I understand in that moment what I'm doing is I am taking her closer to her solution. She doesn't understand in that moment. She thinks I'm making her life infinitely worse. About 30 seconds later, all is good, all is well, she's happy again. And as funny as that journey is to watch in the life of a baby, do you know all of us can be like that sometimes? We can go through a messy time in our life. We can have an area of need in our life. We go to God, our Father. We pray the right prayers. We ask Jesus for help. We're like, God, I need your help. God, I need breakthrough. God, I need a miracle. And so God does what a good father does. He starts to take us on the journey to our breakthrough and to our miracle. But the thing is, sometimes the journey is uncomfortable. And sometimes the journey doesn't make sense. And sometimes on the journey, we feel like things are getting worse before they get better. And so we start to cry. We start to get upset. We start to lose faith in God. God, what are you doing? God, why are you taking this way at me this way in life? God, why aren't you answering my prayers? And the whole time, I feel like I get this picture of God just saying, what's wrong with you? Come on, I'm taking you towards the solution you so desire. The thing is, sometimes the journey gets a little bit messy. Sometimes the journey is hard to understand. And tonight, just for the next 10 minutes, I want to read you a story from the Bible that talks about this journey of faith that God has for every single one of us. And God has a journey of faith for all of us to go on. It is a journey to the greatness of our calling. Sometimes it doesn't always make sense. And I want to read to you tonight out of the Bible in John chapter 11. If you got a Bible or if you're taking notes, you can turn there or you can switch your Bible on or you can start writing down John 11. And I want to tell you the story of a man in the Bible. His name was Lazarus. And he had two sisters, Mary and Martha. And we read about them a few times throughout the Gospels. But in John 11, we find out that Lazarus has gotten really sick. And the Bible tells us that his two sisters, Mary and Martha, send word to Jesus and say, Jesus, your dear friend Lazarus is very sick. You see, they were in relationship with Jesus. They had a friendship with Jesus. And I want to set the scene for this story for just a minute. You know, we hear about Mary and Martha and Lazarus a number of times throughout the Gospels. What we never hear about is their parents. And Bible historians say it's very safe to assume that their parents have died, have passed away, and it is a brother and his two sisters living together. And so you got to understand, back in those Bible days, I didn't make the rules, this is just the way life was back then, that if there was a man living in the house, the man could get a job, the man could make money, could provide money for everyone in the house to live, everyone was happy. But the thing is, Mary and Martha, living with their brother, they obviously weren't married, living with their brother, their parents were dead, it was just the three of them, there was only one man in that house, and only one way for money to come into that house. And so Mary and Martha knew in that moment that their brother was sick. Not only was it their dear brother who they loved, but it was also the only source of income that could possibly come into their house. Which means he wasn't just a brother. He was the key to their future. Their entire future hung on his life and his ability to bring money into the house. You see, I gather that as they watched their brother get sicker and sicker, that they would have been terrified, not just at the thought of losing their brother, which would have been tragic, but terrified at the thought of what even is their future going to be. How are they even going to dream? And so they did what we would teach you to do. They prayed to Jesus. They sent word to Jesus. They said, yo, Jesus, this is the moment we need your help. We got a relationship with you. We got a friendship with you. But right now we got a need. and we got an impossible situation, and we know what you do. We know that you heal. We know that you save people. We know you raise people from the dead. We know nothing is impossible for you. So now's your moment. We need you. They send word to Jesus. Jesus sends word back. It's all good. This is not going to end in death. But then the Bible tells us Jesus stayed exactly where he was. And he stayed, and Lazarus got sicker. And Jesus stayed, and Lazarus got sicker. And Jesus stayed, and eventually Lazarus got so sick that he died. Exactly what Jesus said wouldn't happen, happened. Jesus said, this is not going to end in death. Well, guess what? It ended in death. Lazarus died. The Bible tells us that eventually, finally, after he was already dead, when it was too late, when the whole situation was over, they had no more prayers to pray because he died. Then eventually Jesus said, well, now I might go and visit them. And so he walks his way down to Bethany where Mary and Martha lived. And the Bible says this in John 11, verse 20. When Martha got word that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him. But Mary stayed in the house. Somebody say, stayed in the house. Come on, right at the back, say, stayed in the house. Mary stayed in the house. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if only you had been here, my brother would not have died. If we skip down a few verses, it says this in verse 32. Eventually, Mary decided that she would also go and see Jesus. And when Mary arrived and saw Jesus, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if only you'd been here, my brother would not have died. You see, they both said the same thing. When they met Jesus, they said, Lord, if only you had been here, Lazarus would not have died. You see, they understood that if Jesus had showed up in the presence of Jesus, nothing is impossible. In the presence of Jesus was the solution that they needed. But I didn't tell you part of the story. You see, Martha was the first one to go to Jesus. Martha may not have understood everything that was going on, but she had enough faith to still go and see Jesus. Mary stayed in the house. Mary stayed in her despair. She stayed in her hurt. She stayed in her brokenness. But Martha, for some reason, got up and went and saw Jesus. And when she saw Jesus, she looked at him in the eyes and said, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. Mary, 20 minutes later, probably came and said the same thing. Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. Martha said, Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. But Martha went on and uttered these words. She said, but even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask. She said, but even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask. You see, Mary and Martha both said the same thing. Mary said, Lord, if only you'd been here, my brother would not have died. Martha said, Lord, if only you'd been here, my brother would not have died. But Mary put a full stop. Martha kept going. She may not have understood what she was saying, but she was uttering something profound. She said, but even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask. And what Jesus went on to prove in that moment, he went and stood in front of the grave where they buried Lazarus. He called out in a loud voice. He said, Lazarus, come forth. And in that moment, the man was raised up from the dead. You see, even when their story seemed finished, even when their story seemed over, he was in the grave for 4 days. Even when Mary and Martha's future looked like it was gone, dead and buried, Jesus could still walk into that situation and just with one declaration, turn around the entire situation. He raised that man from the dead and he resurrected their dreams and their hopes for the future. And friend, that is the power of our God, that there is no situation too hard. There is no circumstance too impossible that he can't walk into and bring a turnaround and bring a breakthrough and bring a miracle and bring a healing. And that is why I can stand here tonight and say with great faith that even now God can do anything in your life. Come on, give him a praise if you believe that tonight. I'm going to ask the keyboard player to come back and join me. See, a few years ago, but maybe 2 years ago, we were on tour with our Planet Shakers band and we were in Europe. Keyboard player's coming. Praise God. We were in Europe with our band I remember getting a text message on my phone. We had the day off, which is quite rare when we're away. I remember laying on my bed in my hotel room, I got a text message saying, you need to pray right now. See, we got a church in Cape Town, South Africa. And a good friend of mine is the pastor of that church. His name is Fabian. And we got a text message that we needed to pray for Fabian's daughter. And we found out later why we needed to pray. See, Fabian and his family at that stage, he was married and had three kids. Now he's got four, but at that stage he had three kids. And they'd gone away for a couple of days. And the Bible said, not the Bible, it's a story, sorry. And and they got home from this trip. They were away for a couple of days, and they got home and they all came inside and they were just chilling out. Fabian and his two boys were sitting watching the TV, and after about 5 or 10 minutes, he realized that he hadn't heard his young daughter. And she was about 18 months old at that point in time, and she hadn't heard her for about 10 minutes since they got home. And so he called out to his wife up the other end of the house, said, Have you seen Faith? That's the name of their little daughter. And she said, no, I thought she was with you. And so he jumped up. He's like, no, she's not with me. And so they started searching through the whole house and couldn't see Faith anywhere. And so they thought, oh dear, maybe we were bad parents. We left her in the car accidentally. And so they walked out of the house, out the back of their house. They walked to the driveway to see if she was still in the car. But before they even got to the car, they had to walk past the pool that was in their backyard. And they found their daughter, and she was floating upside down in their pool. They'd been home for about 10 minutes. So the best that they could tell is she'd been floating upside down in this pool for about 10 minutes. And so they grabbed her and they pulled her out. I mean, Fabian's a pastor. He's not a doctor. He doesn't know how to resuscitate someone. So he starts doing the best he could, but he knew he wasn't doing the right things. He just screamed at the top of his lungs. He said, help! I need someone to help. It just so happened that his next door neighbor, who was a paramedic, was for some reason home that day when he wasn't meant to be. But he was home and he ran across and started doing resuscitation upon Fabian's daughter. 15 minutes had gone past. They rung the ambulance. 20 minutes went past. 25 minutes passed. Eventually, the ambulance shows up and they load her into the back of the ambulance, and they were about to stop doing CPR. Fabian looked at them and said, you will keep going. My daughter will live and not die. But there was no sign of life. Half an hour had passed. She hadn't been breathing. They had her in the back of the ambulance. They kept doing CPR on her all the way to hospital. 45 minutes since she'd fallen into that water. No sign of life. 50 minutes passed. 55 minutes. And eventually, after 55 minutes of doing compression on her chest, trying to get oxygen into her body, trying to resuscitate her, eventually she took a breath. And they got her into the hospital. She hadn't breathed for 55 minutes. The human body can't last very long, more than a couple of minutes without oxygen. And it begins to damage the brain. Begins to shut down the organs. So they put her in a hospital. They got her in a coma. They hooked her up to all the machines, and the machines made her body work. They put her on life support. And the doctors came in and ran all of their tests and sat down with Fabian and his wife and began to tell him, your daughter will never live. And if by some miracle she does live, her brain will never function. She will be in a vegetative state for the rest of her life. Her fever was spiking. Her little 18-month-old body couldn't handle the stress that it was going through. My friend Fabian was surrounded by all these reports of what was going to happen. But he decided he didn't want to listen to those reports. He didn't know what to do. He couldn't find himself praying. He couldn't read the word. And he decided eventually he needed to just go and put himself in the presence of God. He didn't know what words to say. He didn't know what scriptures to read. But he knew if he could put himself in the presence of God, he got himself in his car and he just began to switch on this song. It's a song by Planet Shakers. He begins to talk about the power of our declaration. It's called We Speak. We speak life. We speak life in the name of Jesus. Over and over, he would play this worship song. we speak life. And he began to put himself in the presence of God. And see, in the presence of God, all things are made new. In the presence of God is fullness of joy. In the presence of God is healing and breakthrough. In the presence of God is everything we need. He put himself in the presence of God. 2 days, wasn't looking much better. 3 days, her poor body was still raging with the temperature. On the fourth day, the temperature broke and eventually began to return to normal. After 5 days, she began to breathe on her own. After 6 days, her heart began to pump on its own. After 7 or 8 days, they began to wake her up. After 9 days, they began to do all of their tests upon her. And then they did their tests again. Then they did their tests again. The doctors kept coming in to test because the tests kept showing up with results that shouldn't be possible. After 10 days, she was talking on her own. After 11 days, the nurses went to the doctors and said, "You need to discharge this girl because there is nothing wrong with her." And after 11 days, she got herself up out of that bed and on her own 2 feet, she walked herself out of hospital. She is now 3 years old. There is nothing wrong with her. Her brain is completely fine. She is absolutely, completely healed. Everything the doctor said was impossible became possible. Why? Because in the presence of God, all things are possible. I want to tell you tonight, young person. I want to tell you tonight, older person. It doesn't matter the situation you may find yourself in. It doesn't matter the impossibilities that may be facing you. It doesn't matter the doctor's report you may have received. It doesn't matter what someone may have declared over your future. That in the presence of God, all things are possible. I want to stir your faith tonight that as we put ourselves in His presence, as we put our faith in Him, that He is a God who can do all things. And if you believe that tonight, I want to invite you to stand to your feet and lift up a shout of praise all over this room. Come on, if you believe that, would you give God a praise tonight? Come on, is that it? Is that all you believe God for? See, here's the thing. I don't think you're getting it. You're yelling right now because I'm telling you to yell, which is very obedient. But it's not really a praise. I wonder if you could grab a hold of this in the presence of God tonight. There is nothing impossible for our God. All over this room, would you do me a favor and close your eyes? Do you understand that God is on your side? I know that all over this room, there are people that are facing impossible situations. There are young people and people are declaring over your future that you can't do what's in your heart to do. You'll never get into that course. You'll never get into that job. You'll never marry that girl. You'll never be able to do this. You'll never be able to. People are declaring over your future. But God has put a dream in your heart. And we have a choice tonight. We can choose to live by the limitations of the world we find ourselves in. Or we can choose to live in the impossibilities of heaven, where in God's presence, all things are possible. There are older people in this room tonight and you're bound up by the economy of where you find yourself, in your business, in your workplace, in your city. You have a choice tonight. You can live according to the economy of the world, or you can live according to the economy of heaven. And last time I checked, God hasn't run out of goodness. God hasn't run out of provision. God hasn't run out of blessing. God hasn't run out of favor. See, all over this room, there are people that are facing impossible situations. But I wonder tonight if, like Martha, we may not understand how God can do it, and we may not understand when God will do it, but if we would have the faith to say, "God, I wish you showed up when I asked you to show up, because then I wouldn't find myself here. But I still choose to believe that even now you can do anything. And even now you can work a miracle. That even now you are up to good, because that is what you do. God is good and He is good all the time. God is on our side. God will fight our battles for us. God will never leave us or forsake us. That even now, God wants to work a miracle in your life. And now I want to ask you, if you have faith to believe that God would move in your life, now I want to invite you to give Him a shout of praise all over this place. Come on, church. Come on, church, if you believe that, would you lift your praise to heaven in this place? Come on, that even now, even if you've done what you've done, He wants to move. Even if you're not qualified like you think you should be, He wants to move through you. Even if you don't know Jesus yet, He has a plan for your life. Even if you're still young, He wants to use you in this place. Come on, young people, insecure people, people who might be in love with the world, people who might be stuck in their shame, people who might be caught in impossibilities, God wants to move in your life tonight. All over this room, would you raise your hands high and close your eyes? I believe that God wants to fill people with dreams and visions of His impossibility. See, in the presence of God, impossible turns into I am possible. See, in the I am, all things are possible. All over this room, come on, would you open your heart? Allow the Holy Spirit to fill you. So I open up my heart to you. To move in your life, if you have an impossible situation, if you have an area where the enemies come against faith in your heart, if you have a need in your life where you need God to bring His breakthrough, to bring His miracle power, you may need a miracle in your body, you may need a miracle in your circumstances, you may need the power of God to move in your life. All over this room, if you need God to move, would you raise your hands high? Come on, tonight, as we make this declaration, I'm believing that God will come and move like only He can. Come on, would you sing? Here in this moment,
anything can happen. Miracles forever flowing in this place. Everybody welcome, Jesus King of heaven.
Come on, welcome.
is moving in this place this evening. If any of you say that, Lord, I need you, lift it up to God. Lift it up to God. Don't be ashamed that someone is going to see me. Don't be ashamed that someone is going to look at me. Don't be ashamed. If today you are that person who says that, God, I need you. If today that you are that person who says, God, I'm struggling with addiction, God is here to break through. If you are that person who's saying, God, I'm struggling with inferiority, negativity, suicidal thoughts, God is here to break it. If you are that person who says that, God, I've come here to hide behind the pillar so that nobody can see me, He's telling you, I see you through. I have searched you. And I have found you. Even before you were found in your mother's womb, I saw you. I knit you together. I know when you wake up. I know when you go to sleep. I know what you eat. I know where you sit. Where can you go away from my presence? Where can you go away from my presence? Where can you go away from my presence? He's here this evening to do miracles that you have not even expected. God wants this evening His people to expect more. To expect more. To expect more. Come on, anyone here in this room who says, God, I'm going to expect more, lift it up to God and say, Jesus, we need you. Father, we need you. Father, we need you. Enjoy His presence in this moment. To God who was and is to come, to power of the risen, to God who raised the dead to life. God of miracles, you're the God of miracles. They lift your voice and sing again. The God is blessed. Bless you, Jesus. We lift your name on high. Lord, we lift your name on high. Come on, would you open up your mouth and begin to praise Him this evening? Sing out your own song to Him. Many a times we sing songs that is written by Hillsong or Planet Shakers or different artists, but God is saying, I want to listen to the song that's ringing in your heart that nobody has ever heard before, that nobody has ever sung before. Sing out to Him this evening. Sing out to Him. If you are feeling pain, sing out your pain. If you are feeling joy, sing out your joy. There is none like you. Can't touch my heart like you do, and I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. Will you sing it once again? There is none. There is none like you. Touch my heart like you do, and I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. For you are great, and you do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one. Thank you, Father, for your presence. How many of you are enjoying this evening? Amen. Come on, is that all you can shout? Come on, a little more louder. Refuse to agree with the lies they told me, so I take my possession, speak to all my conditions, take the authority you won for me. Come on, sing it. The word of the Lord to bring about a change full of your power. I step out, declare aloud your praise. I prophesy.